Good afternoon. Let us continue our discussion about convolutional codes. In the previous two classes, we have discussed the basics of convolutional codes and also how to draw the encoder circuit given the N, K, and M values, how to find the convolutional code in the time domain using three different methods. Today, let's move on to finding the convolutional code in transform domain. In the transform domain approach, we know that for any linear system, time domain operation involves convolution of the input with the impulse response of the system. But when we convert from time domain to frequency domain, say for example in communication circuits, we convert from time to frequency domain, the same convolution operation becomes multiplication. So it's easier for us to work with multiplication rather than convolution very often. In convolutional encoding or in finding convolutional codes, we also do the same transformation. We call this approach as transform domain approach. So since a convolutional encoder can be viewed as a linear time invariant finite state machine or a linear time invariant system, we can simplify computation of the adder outputs by putting the appropriate transformation. So we have multiple adders and we can simplify all those by using the correct transformations. And for that, we are going to use polynomial algebra like how we did in cyclic codes. We can write each of these operations using polynomial equations, and every corresponding polynomial and convolution operation will be replaced with polynomial multiplication. See here, the convolution in time domain will represent linear filtering operation like this. Say I have a message m of t, the impulse response is h of t. Then if I pass this message through a system having impulse response h of t, the output would be the convolution of m of t with h of t, which is represented either like this or like this, integral of m of t into h of t minus tau. This integration is nothing but a low pass filter, a linear low pass filter, and it eliminates the high frequency components in the signal. So as we discussed before, very often we try to analyze the signal in frequency domain. The same operation in frequency domain becomes m of f into h of f. It's a product multiplication operation. Just like this, we are going to convert the time domain operation of convolution into a transform domain operation of multiplication using polynomial algebra. So we'll represent the input data sequence as a polynomial equation in X or D. We can use the variable. The variable here can be X or D. Please remember, variable you can use either in X or D. Because we use D, we very often call this transform domain approach also as D domain approach to convolution. So we can find the polynomial equations, and it's optional. We can write it in variable X or D and simplify. The data is also represented in the variable. The generator is also represented in the same variable. And in the end, we are going to multiply both data with the generator to get the required code. So let's take an example. Consider a 2-1M code. The encoding equations will look something like this. See, the first encoded output V1 of X. This is the output of the first adder, output of first mod 2 adder. Right, we call that code as V1 of X is U of X into G1 of X. Remember, here n is 2, k is 1, m is any given number. So I can have any number of flip-flops, but I'll have only 2 modulo 2 adders in this circuit. So either here or here, and I'm going to have this output switch, output line, which will connect either to this. This I'm going to call adder 1, and whatever inputs I have, the output here, we are going to call it as V1. Output from this adder, we are going to call it as V2. And when we write them as polynomial functions, we get V1 of x is the data polynomial u of x. So this is the data or message polynomial, and the generator polynomial, we also call it as the impulse response. So the generator polynomial of the upper sequence, each sequence has a separate generator, please remember. So generator polynomial of the upper sequence, this into data will give you V1. This is V1 of X. Similarly, generator polynomial of the second sequence. How do we get this generator? By considering all the inputs which come to this modulo 2 adder. Remember, we have the actual input, the delayed version of the inputs, depending upon in which time instant they have entered the encoder. Okay. Now, this V2 of X can be written as G2 of X into U of X. U of X is our message polynomial or the data polynomial as shown here. So U of X is a data expressed in terms of the polynomial in variable X. So U1 plus U2 x plus u3 x square plus u4 x cubed, so on. And remember here u1, u2, u3 and all are coefficients of the given polynomial. Similarly, after this multiplication in polynomial algebra, the code v1 of x becomes v1 of 1, v2 of 1 into x, V3 of 1 into x, so on. So all these V1, V2, V3 are coefficients. Okay. Now, V2 of x can also be written as V1 of 2, V2 of 2x, V3. All these coefficients, we are just writing a given code vector in terms of a polynomial equation in variable x. See, for example, if V2 is 1011, then V2 of x will be 1. This is x power 0, 1 into x power 0 plus 0 into x plus 1 into x square plus 1 into x cubed. So the actual equation for V2 of x will be 1 plus x square plus x cubed. That's what we are representing here. This representation only means this. Okay. And we have done this often with cyclic codes, so you should be familiar now. Starting from the LSB, we'll go on writing it as a polynomial equation in X. Similarly, the generator also, we are going to express it as a polynomial equation in X. Generator G1, the upper generator, G1 of 1, G1, G2 of 1 into x, G3 of 1 into x square, so on. Similarly, the lower generator, G2. So this is the upper one, this is the lower one. Same equation for both. They are expressed as polynomial equations in the variable x. Okay. And once we do this, the final code vector or the final code polynomial V of x, please make a note of this, is defined as V1 of x square plus x into V2 of x square. See, we have found V2 of x and V1 of x here. V1 of x is found, V2 of x is found here. But I should find V1 of x square and V2 of x square. In the sense, I have to replace x with x square in the equations. And why do we do this? this x square, the square value is mainly y because the n value is 2. So what should I replace the original variable with, whether it is x square or x cube? That is considered based on the value of n. Okay, it is based on n. If n is 2, it is replaced with x square. If it is 3, I'll replace it with x cubed. And look at the multiplexed equation, how we combine. The first part, v1 of x square, we write it as it is. The second part will be x into v2 of x square. Likewise, if I'm going to extend this, this will be x square into v3 of x square, so on. And each time you go, it will be x power n minus 1 into vn of x square. I can go on extending this to any value n. This indeterminate x can be regarded as the unit delay operator. The variable x, or I told you, very often we consider it as d also. It can be considered as the unit delay operator. And the power of x defining number of time units by which the associate bit is delayed with respect to the initial bit in the sequence. So x is the unit delay operator, and the power of x tells us by how many delays are encountered. So if the power of x is just 1, that means it is delayed by 1 time unit. If it is 2, x square, it is delayed by 2 time units, so on, and everything in comparison with the initial bit sequence. Okay, so all we have to do in transform domain approach is to write both the data as well as generator in terms of a polynomial equation in the variable x or d, and then multiply both data with the generator to get the required code polynomial. And that you will get individual code polynomials for each modulo 2 adder. And to get the final code polynomial after multiplexing, the final stage multiplexer or commutator, after that, the code polynomial is obtained using this equation, v1 of x to the power of n plus x into v2 of x power n plus x square into v3 of x power n, so on. Okay. So this is the final equation which we have to remember. So let's consider the first example where we have considered a 2, 1, 3 encoder, and the impulse responses of this encoder were 1011 and 1111. So how do I write a 2, 1, 3 encoder? Remember, K is 1. So one input line, and how many memory elements? M is 3. So 3 memory elements I should consider. 1, 2, 3. 3 memory elements. And what is the n value? N value is 2. Therefore, 2 modulo 2 adders should be considered. And the final commutator segment will take. So this is v1 of whatever, we'll just consider it as v1, and this is v2. Okay, and this is the upper modulo 2 adder 1, this is the second. The generator sequences are given. For the upper one, it is 1011. Remember, the points which I should consider starts from the input. The input is given here, 1. This point should not be considered, it is 0 here. The third point is 1, and the last point is also 1. So I should consider all these 4 points, or leaving the second point. And the output of this generator will be connected to this point in the output multiplexer. And for the second generator, all are 1s. So I should input all these points. So this is the present input. This is the previous input. This was the input given 2 time states before, and this was the input given 3 time states before. And finally, this output is connected to the second point in the switch V2. Okay. So this is the 2, 1, 3 encoder which we had considered, and the impulse responses are as shown. So we should write the generator polynomials for the impulse responses. G1 of x will be 1 into x power 0 plus 0 into x, no x term, plus 1 into x square plus 1 into x cubed. So I'll get g1 of x like this. G2 of x will have all the terms. So 1 plus x square plus x cubed. Okay. And the information sequence is given as 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. So the corresponding polynomial for the information sequence is 1 plus x square plus x cube plus x power 4. Only the x term is 0. Okay. Now, let's try to find the code polynomial. To find the code polynomial v1 of x for the upper adder here, if I have to find v1 of x, what should I do? I have to multiply the given data polynomial with the upper generator polynomial g1 of x. So we have taken the data polynomial u of x and multiplied it with the upper generator g1 of x. And when I simplify this, I'm going to get the value as 1 plus x power 7. Remember, it's always modulo 2 addition. In modulo 2 addition, x plus x is 0, x square is 0, 1 plus 1 is 0. So based on this, when we do individual multiplication, in the end, we are going to get 1 plus x power 7. Similarly, to find the code polynomial for the second adder v2 of x, multiply the data with generator 2. So this is the data and this is generator 2. You end up with this polynomial 1 plus x cubed plus x power 4 plus x power 5 plus x power 7. So this is the value of v2 of x. Now let's try to express v1 of x and v2 of x as a coefficient vector. I'll extract the coefficients of this equation. You see, the coefficient of x power 0 is 1, the coefficient of x power 7 is 1. So I'm going to have 1 in the first and last place, and in between everything is filled with 0. Okay. And how many bits should be there in the code depends on what is the length of the, how will I know how to find? The total number of bits, the total number of bits should always be capital L plus M. How much is L? There are 5 bits in the message. So it is 5 plus 3. I should have 8 bits in each code vector. V1 should have 8 bits. V2 should also have 8 bits. Now extract the coefficients of V2. X power 0 coefficient is 1. X coefficient is 1. X square term is not there, 0. X cube coefficient is 1. X power 4, 5 are there, 1, 1. 6 is not there, 0. 7 is there. So again, 8 bit coefficient. Now the last stage is multiplexer. So multiplexing these two code polynomials, v1 of x and v2 of x, we are taking the coefficients of v1 of x and listing here. The coefficients of v2 of x we are taking and listing here based on the power of x power, starting the leftmost bit is x power 0 coefficient, x coefficient, x square coefficient, x cube, so on till x power 7. Okay. And the total number of bits should be L plus M. Capital L indicates number of bits in the data polynomial. Number of bits in the data polynomial is 5. L, capital L is 5. And number of memory elements, flip-flops, is 3. So 5 plus 3 is 8. Hence, both the code vectors should have 8 bits each. And the final multiplexed code word, V of x, which we get, which goes out on the transmission line, will be the interleaving bits of the corresponding bits of V1 and V2. So first bit of V1, first bit of V2, 1, 1. second bit of V1, second bit of V2, 0, 1. Third bit of V1, third bit of V2, like this. So on, this would be the code, final code vector. And we have obtained this using the polynomial based transform domain approach. And if you verify this with the time domain result, the answers should match. The code polynomial should remain the same whether you obtain it using time domain approach or the frequency domain, or the transform domain approach. If we want to write the final code polynomial in terms of the variable x to get the expression for the final code polynomial, remember, how do we state the final code polynomial equation is V of x is obtained as V1 of x square plus x into V2 of x square. Remember, I should consider x square because n is 2. We have V1 of x given like this. Therefore, what would be V1 of x square? Replace x with x square. So I'll get 1 plus x square to the power of 7, which is x to the power of 14. I'll get this as 1 plus x power 14, V1 of x. V2 of x, wherever I have x, I should substitute x square instead of x. Therefore, 1 plus x square. This will be x square to the power of 3, which will be x power 6. X square to the power of 4, x power 8. X square to the power of 5, x power 10. X square to the power of 7, x power 14. So this is the code polynomial V2 of x square. Now we should multiply V2 of x square with x. In the final equation, V2 of x square gets multiplied with x. So we are doing x V2 of x square. I'm multiplying this equation with x. I'll get x plus x cube plus x power 7. Wherever add 1, remember the powers we have to add, x power 11 plus x power 15. Now, the final code polynomial V of x is V1 of x square, 1 plus x power 14 plus x into V2 of x square. Okay, so 1 plus x plus x cube plus x power 7 plus x power 9 plus x power 11. So we are just taking all the sum of this and this, and x power 14 and 15. So this will be the final expression. And if I extract the coefficients from this expression, I'm going to get x power 0 is 1, x is 1, x square is not there, 0, x cubed is 1. Likewise, 4, 5, 6 are not there, 3 zeros, 7 is there, 1, 8 is not there, 0. 9 is there, 1, 10 is not there, 0. Likewise, you go on getting, and you can compare this with the answer what we got previously. It should remain the same again. Whether I get it from the final equation of the code polynomial and then extract the coefficients, or whether you extract the individual coefficients of the code polynomials here itself. So x power 0, x, x square, x cubed, x power 4, 5, 6, 7, 8-bit code vector, and then interleave 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1. So interleave these bits, you'll again get the same thing, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. The same answer we've got here, okay? Previously, we did like this by writing the individual code vectors and then interleaving. Now we have written the complete code polynomial, the final equation after the multiplexer and extracted the coefficients. All should give you the same answer. So the generator polynomials of an encoder can be determined directly from its circuit diagram. Specifically, the coefficient of x is a 1. If there is a connection from the lth shift register stage to the input of the adder of interest and a 0 otherwise. we know how to consider the generator polynomial. We have already done that. So if there is a connection from the output or input of that shift register to the adder, it will be a 1. If there is no connection, it will be a 0. We saw that here. So for the upper polynomial, it is 1011. The lower one is 1111. All four ones. At all four places, there is a connection. Okay. So with this, let's move on to example 2. In example 2, we are considering a 313 convolutional encoder given the impulse responses G1, G2, G3. Three generator sequences or impulse responses are given. You're supposed to find the convolutional code for the message sequence 1101 in transform domain approach. Also verify using time domain approach. So first let's draw the diagram. It should have 3 modulo 2 adders as n is 3. Therefore 1, 2, 3 modulo 2 adders are there. The input comes 1 bit at a time. So the message comes just 1 bit at a time, a single connection. No multiplexer or switch on the input side. And whereas on the output side, I should generate 3 code bits per message bit. So I should have 3 points in the switch or 3 modulo 2 adders, sorry, 3 flip-flops. Here, this is M value. M should be 3. It should have 3 flip-flops or 3 memory elements. Okay. Now, we have to consider the inputs to the modulo 2 adders using these impulse responses or generator sequence. G1 is 1011, G2 1101. So first let's write G1, the upper modulo 2 adder. 1 means a connection from the input side. 0, there is no connection from the input of the second flip-flop. 1, output of the second flip-flop or input to the third should be connected. A 1 here, output of the third flip-flop should be connected. Therefore, 1011. Next, G2 for the second modulo 2 adder, it is 1101. So the input from this point, 1110, this point is not connected. And finally, this point is connected, 1101. And the last generator sequence is 1111. So all the points should be connected, all the 4 points should be connected, 1111. You'll get 1111. Now, all these generator sequences should be connected to different points in the multiplexer, and the final switch should be connected to take one of the inputs and feed it to the transmission line. This is the circuit diagram. Now, let's move on to express the given message and the generator sequence as polynomial functions. I told you, you can either use D as the variable or X. Here we are trying to use D as the variable just to show that both can be used. I told you because we are using D, this is also known as D domain approach to convolutional encoding. What was the given message sequence? The message sequence was 1101. So 1 plus D plus D cubed. Instead of X, it is D, that's all. And G1 of D was 1011, 1 plus D square plus D cubed. G2 of D was 1101, 1 plus D cubed. G3 of D was 1111, 1 plus D square plus D cubed. So we have expressed all the given generators as well as the message as polynomial functions in the variable D. Now our job is easy. We can find the corresponding code polynomials. Here we are calling the code polynomials as C. So instead of V, I can also call it as V1 of D or V1 of X. Anything could be used. Okay, here. C1 of D indicates the first code polynomial message into the first generator. So the message is given as 1 plus D plus D cube into first generator is 1 plus D square plus D cube. When we multiply and cancel out like terms, similar terms should be cancelled out. You'll get C1 of D as 1 plus D square plus D cube plus D power 5 plus D power 6 and D power 4. If you arrange it in the right order, you'll get it right. So I have one D power 0 term, D power 1 term, D square, D cubed, D power 4, 5, 6, all ones. So in this code sequence, all ones. Again, what should be the length of this? How many bits I should have? I told you this C1 should be a 1 cross L plus M row vector. How much is L? The message is L is 4 here. A 4-bit length message is given. So 4. And how many flip-flops in the given circuit? M value is 3. 3 flip-flops. Therefore, 4 plus 3. I should have a 1 cross 7 row vector for each code. Okay, each modulo 2 adder output is a 1 cross 7 code vector. Now, for everything, I should find C1 D to the power of N. Remember, N is equal to 3 in this case. So after finding C1 of D here, I'll have to find C1 of D cubed. How do we do that? We replace D with D cubed everywhere. So I will get 1 plus D cubed plus D cubed the whole square, that is D power 6 plus D cubed the whole cubed, D power 9 plus D to the power of 4, the D cubed the whole to the power of 4, D power 12, D cubed the whole to the power of 5, D power 15, D cubed the whole to the power of 6, that is 6 3 is 18, D power 18. So this is the first part of the code polynomial. Likewise, we'll find C2 of D as message into the second generator. This would be your result. Write that in terms of what? A code vector in ones and zeros. Extract the coefficients and write it as a code vector in ones and zeros. 1 cross 7 matrix. And you also have to find C2 of D cubed. So once you find C2 of D cubed, you get this. You can also go one step further and find D into what? C2 of D cubed. You could even do this. Likewise, we have to find C3 of D, G3 of D into M of D. M of D is 1 plus D cubed given here. G3 of D is 1 plus D square plus D cubed. When we simplify, we'll get this. And I'm doing C3 of D cubed to get this result. And what is the value of C3? Here, C3 of D is, you have 100. There is no D or D square term. So 100, D cubed is there, 1. 4 is not there, 0. D power 5 is there, D power 6 is there, 100, 1011. So this is how it's going to work. Now the final convolutional code, how do I get? If I want it in the form of a polynomial equation, it is D power 0 into C1 of D power n. Here in this case, it is D cubed plus D into C2 of D cubed plus D square into C3 of D cubed. I have three terms. Therefore, I should multiply it with D power 0, D power 1 and D square. And since we have already obtained what is C1 of D cubed, I multiply it with 1. So D power 0 is 1. And I'll multiply C2 of D cubed with D and C3 of D cubed with D square. And when we simplify everything, this is the final polynomial equation. And if we want the final code vector, the final code vector C is obtained by extracting the coefficients of this equation. Coefficient of d power 0, 1, d power 1, 1, d square 1, d cubed 1, d power 4 and 5 are not there, 0, 0, 6, 7 are there, 1, 1, 8 not there, 0. Likewise, you go on doing, you get this. Or if you want to verify, you can also consider what was C1, C2 and C3 in terms of row vectors which we listed here. C1 was all ones, C2 101001, C3 100101011. So listing that, what should I do to get the final code vector? You just have to interleave the bits. First bit of all three, you'll get this. Second bit of all three, you're going to get this. Third bit of all three, like that. And this should be same as what you got here. So if you have done some mistake while writing the final equation here, you would know once you do this. Okay. This is a simpler way to do it. Now, we have another better option known as the transfer function matrix. So we can find the transfer function matrix for a given polynomial function using transfer domain approach, using the generator polynomials. So remember, the encoder is a linear system and UL of X represents the lth input sequence. VJ of X represents the jth output sequence. The generator polynomial is GL of X to the power of J. It can be regarded as the encoder transfer function relating the input L to the output J. Okay, it should relate the input L to the output J. For the K input N output linear system, remember we consider N, K, M. So K is input, N is output. For the K input N output linear system, we can write it as a transfer function matrix of order K cross N. Okay. So K cross N transfer functions can be written in the matrix as shown below. Actually, this will give you a very easy way to solve complicated problems in convolutional coding. When the K value is more than 1, when K is 2, 3 and all, writing this transfer function matrix proves to be a good and easy job. So you can see here, the generator matrix, polynomial matrix G of X could be written as G1, 1 of X, G1, 2 of X, G1, N of X, likewise, first row. So first row is completely based on G1. Second row is based on G2, G2 1 of X, G2 2 of X, so on. And the kth row, remember we should have k rows. So kth row is GK 1 of X, GK 2 of X, likewise. So this is how you're going to compute the generator matrix or the transfer function matrix. When we take up the example, you'll understand this much more clearly. Now, once I have this transfer function matrix, we can easily find the code polynomial V of X by multiplying the data polynomial U of X with this generator matrix G of X. And what is U of X? We know U of X has, it's a polynomial. It is going to have U1 of X, U2 of X, UK of X. It's a k-bit code vector. The message, it represents the information, and V of X is the output code, V1 of X, V2 of X, Vn of X. This is the n-bit code vector, k-bit message, n-bit code vector. And after here, rather than calling a vector, I can say they are sequences. It's a k input sequence, n output sequence. And after multiplexing, what would happen to the final code word? It can be written as V of X is V1 of X power N plus x into v2 of x bar n plus x square into v3 of x bar n, x to the power of n minus 1 into vn of x bar n. We have already written this equation before. So let's take up this example 3, where we have the encoder here, which is a, what encoder is this? There are two input lines. So k value is 2. How many modulo 2 adders? 3 modulo 2 adders. So 3 comma 2 comma, how many memory elements per line? 1. It's a 3-2-1 convolutional encoder. Okay. So the diagram shown here is a 3 comma 2 comma 1 convolutional encoder. We have already considered this, and in time domain, we worked, solved this to find the code, convolutional code. Now, if I have to find the upper generators, it is based on this flip-flop. This is for the upper value, right? And this is for the lower value. Now, you can go on finding what are the connections to the adders due to the upper flip-flop. In the first adder, the input as well as output is connected. So G1 of 1 will be 1-1. For the second order, input is connected, but output is not connected. G1 of 2 will be 1-0. For the third one, input is connected, output is not connected. G1 of 3 is 1-0. Likewise, if I have to consider the second input line U2, then I should take into account the second flip-flop and again consider all the three adders. What are the connections from the second flip-flop to these three adders? That would give me the generators G2. G1, I have it here. So G2 of 1, which means for the first adder, check out whether the input is connected. The input line is not connected, whereas the output side is connected. So it is a 0-1. For the second one, the input side, you can see here, the input side as well as output side, both are connected. So it's a 1-1. For the third adder, input is connected, but output is not connected. Sorry, the input also is not connected. It's coming from here. So for the third one, I don't have any connections from either side of this second flip-flop. So it's a 0-0. Okay. Now, once you have this, it is very easy for us to express these values as polynomial function. I can write G1 of 1 as G1 of 1 of x. I told you, you can write it in x or d, 1 plus x. Next, G1 of 2 can be written as G1 of 2 of x. It is a 1-0. So just 1 plus 0 into x. It is just 1. And G1 of 3 is also 1. Okay. All these are polynomial functions in x. Similarly, what is G2 of 1? It is 0 plus x. It is x. G2 of 2 is 1 plus x because both are 1s. And G2 of 3 is 0. So these are the polynomial functions for the generators for the upper as well as lower input line, U of 1 and U of 2. Now, we can write this transfer function matrix or the generator polynomial matrix G of x by considering this G1 of 1, G1 of 2, the upper generator, right? The lower generator G2 of 1, G2 of 2, G2 of 3 can be written. We got the values 1 plus x, 1 and 1 for the upper. For the second one, x, 1 plus x and 0. We have just filled it up to get the transfer function matrix. Now you have the given information or the data. U1 is 1, 0, 1. U2 is 1, 1, 0. So let us write both as polynomial function. U1 of x will be 1 plus 0 plus x square. So it is 1 plus x square, and u2 of x would be 1 plus x, 1, 1, 0. Therefore, x power 0 term is 1, x power 1 term is 1, 1 plus x. Okay. Now, how do I find the code polynomial? It is v1 of, it will have three different code vectors because I have three modulo 2 adders. So this v will have v1 of x, v2 of x, and v3 of x. Three code polynomials individually. How to get that? I should take the data polynomials as a row matrix. So this is a 1 cross 2 row matrix because two different streams of data are given. Both are written as polynomial functions that multiplied with the generator matrix or the transfer function matrix. Now, if we do, we know how to multiply each. So this will be actually 1 plus x square into 1 plus x. This first element into first element of the first column. The second element into second element of the first column. So all this put together, it will simplify to just 1 plus x cubed. So if you simplify this, if you multiply and try to simplify, it will simplify to the value 1 plus x cubed. Similarly, if I take, so I'm going to get 1 plus x cubed here. If I multiply 1 plus x square into 1 plus 1 plus x into 1 plus x, I'm going to get 0. That is the second element. And the last element, 1 plus x square into 1, this element into this, plus 1 plus x into 0. 1 plus x into 0. This will give you 1 plus x square. We directly have this 0 go off. So I have the third element. Hence, the code polynomials are v1 of x is 1 plus x cubed, v2 of x is 0, v3 of x is 1 plus x square. How do I find the final code polynomial v of x? Remember, v1 of x cubed. Why should I take x cubed? Because n is 3 here. Right, the number of code bits or modulo 2 adders is 3. So find v1 of x cubed plus x into v2 of x cubed plus x square into v3 of x cubed. And if you substitute these values, I have to put x cubed in place of x. So I'll get it as 1 plus x cubed the whole cubed, which is 3 into 3, 9. 1 plus x power 9 for the first term. Second term is 0, so it is x into 0. And the third term is x square into, what is this value? 1 plus x cubed the whole square, which will give you 1 plus x power 6. Now, if we rearrange these terms after multiplication, I'm going to get 1 plus x square plus x power 8 plus x power 9, which would reduce to this if I extract the coefficients. Coefficient of x power 0 is 1. Coefficient of x term is not there. X square is there. X power 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 are not there. X power 8 is there. X power 9 is there. 10 and 11 are not there. Okay. So the total length of the code vector should be what? N into L plus M. How much is N? N is 3. L was, what was the length of the input message? 3 bits, right? So 3 bits plus how many flip-flops? I'll be having 3 into 3 plus 1 flip-flop per input sequence. And 3 bits per input sequence. So total number of output sequences is 3. Therefore, 3 into 4 or 12 bits you should have. The final output should have 12 bits as shown. Okay. And if you check this with the time domain approach, which we had done, you'll see that the final value matches with whatever we got with the time domain approach. Therefore, the outcome of this class is we have understood how to write a convolutional code for an NKM convolutional encoder and using transform domain approach. Here it is transform domain using transform domain approach. And we have also understood, given the NKM values, how we can draw the encoder circuit for a convolutional code. So let's stop with this and let's continue with decoding of the convolutional code or other methods in the next class. Thank you.